All right, without further delay, we're going to ask Dr. Donaldson. You know, they have a wealth of experience and a wealth of knowledge and commitment. I mean, we can just go on and on and on. But they have seen revival in this famous hour. And they are seeing the vision, the attention, the vision that we have here. I believe that something is about to explode here at Northside. But we're on that path, but it's going to take commitment, commitment, and commitment. And they're going to help us this morning to understand the importance of commitment if we want to see God's blessings and God's fullness manifested in this ministry and in our families. Without further delay, we just appreciate both of them. It's hard to find a couple that will do what they do, but they are God's chosen ministers in this hour. Let's say praise the Lord. Amen. Let's receive it. Everybody standing on your feet. Let's receive this great name of God. I say praise the Lord.
Amen. When I was set out. Glory to God. How's everyone?
Yes.
Praise the Lord. So all I want to do is praise the Lord. One of the men tremendous.
Amen.
One of the men tremendous. As soon as I get situated here, we're going to make this a little informal. This is good. That's what I have for you today. I want to do it in kind of an informal way. I just want to kind of talk to you about some things that the Lord laid on my heart, and get a little situated here. Got to get my notes together. My boots together. My Bible all going. First of all, I'd like to thank Pastor Lister Seale for this opportunity to come up here. I don't take this for granted. Not one iota. This is a privilege and it's an honor to come up here and speak to you all in this Sunday. Got a little nugget about what Sunday is. Not by coincidence that I'm up here today. Not by coincidence whatsoever. But I give honor to my wife. You know, they say better half. But that's kind of a play. When you come to marriage class, we're gonna deal with some of those little innuendos, because those play to say that she is my better half. She's good half, kind of denounces the position of the other half. And we got in these end times to strengthen the marriage. Marriage is honor. You don't go to the father and say, Jesus got something you ain't got. No, you don't do that. And you use the word marriage for a reason. Marriage is built. We get into that and when we get into our class, because the marriage is awesome. I mean, he uses this word demonstrate his relationship between him and Israel. So we need to really understand. And he uses this word to demonstrate his relationship between Jesus and the church. And if we don't understand that, and we don't, it's gotten kind of lost. But we will come 26 and for 8 weeks we're going to get into that. So thank you, my beautiful wife, for sticking with me. Thank you very much. I'm going to try to take this a little. I'm kind of waiting on the Holy Spirit because of some things I'm going to talk to you about, and it goes along with pastors have been trying to do and bring this church up with the Lord has laid on his heart. Let's just start off first. Let's just everybody stand. Let's raise those Bibles and do a quick confession here. Give them a pie. Say, this is my Bible.
This is my Bible.
And I am the redeemed.
I am the redeemed.
And my Bible says.
And my Bible says.
Let the redeemed say so.
Let the redeemed say so.
So I say. That I'm healthy.
I'm healthy.
Wealthy.
Wealthy.
Wise.
Wise.
I'm ahead.
And not
to tell. I'm very good looking.
I'm very good looking.
Magnificent and wonderfully made.
And wonderfully made.
a major,
a major,
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 blessing,
blessing,
going somewhere to happen.
Going somewhere to happen.
Let's praise the Lord real quick. Glory to God. Because He made it that way. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Dear Heavenly Father, in the name of Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we come to you right now, Father God, asking you to open us up right now, Heavenly Father. Open up our eyes that we may see, our ears that we may hear, and our heart that we receive all we have for you. For we know that your Spirit, your Holy Spirit is our teacher, O Heavenly Father. So teach them through me, O Heavenly Father. Something that I might say, one may hear a little differently because you tweak their ear to hear what you have them to hear. They may grow and develop and be what you want them to be, O Heavenly Father. So we just thank you right now, Father God, for the presence of your Holy Spirit. And we give all you the praise and glory for all that we achieve in this meeting, this worship service, this session right now. In Jesus' name, amen. Everybody have a seat. That picnic was awesome yesterday.
Yeah.
That was awesome. All those that work and participate, give yourself a round of applause. That was really awesome. But that picnic stuck on my head. Come down there a little bit. Stuck in my head because if something was accomplished in that picnic. I've been to a lot of church picnics. I've been to family reunion picnics. But I was truly impressed with this picnic. Why? I mentioned it to someone I was talking to. Him. Most picnics you go to seem like every time they're there, and they got to have loud music to make the social affair. We didn't have any loud music, whether it's Christian or whatever. Everybody, the loudest was the socializing. People having fun. That overshadowed everything. Not the music. Now that really impressed me. I heard it. Because then that was the Holy Spirit just rise up in me. And then the conversations we had, the men, I don't know what you women were doing. I know y'all having fun over there, because I heard the laughter and everything come up. But men got in some very heavy conversations that I'm going to comment on here in a minute. But let me give you one nugget before I really get into my sermon today, my word for you today. It's not by coincidence that I'm up here today. Last time I was up here, what happened? It was a Jewish holiday. Well, this time, it's a Jewish holiday. Let me just give you a little nugget on what the holiday is. The holiday is called Feast of Trumpets. The rabbinical Jews calls it Rosh Hashanah. That's a real deep rabbinical Jews. They call it Rosh Hashanah, meaning Rasha means head. And Hashanah, I get this pronunciation, but means year. So, in one aspect of Jews, this is the beginning of the new year for them. They believe, the deep rabbinical Jews believe that God created Adam on this day. So this brings about it. I'm just giving you a little nugget. There's something about. But the traditional Jews call this day Yom Tohor, which means Feast Day of Trumpet or Feast of Trumpet. I'll give you a little history on that. The reason they call it the Day of Trumpet because on this day is when God called all the Israelites to the base of the Mount Sinai. And God was going to speak to them. I'll give you Micah's version. And when God came to speak to them, he came with them with a loud trumpet. And when he came with them with that, it scared them. They're scared of, so they say, Moses, hey, we can't handle this. You go take care of this. But what that represents, that loud trumpet brings the glory of God. But I'll get into a deep history about it. We're in the end times. We need to start listening for that trumpet. Because God is coming again. And it says, when the last trump. When the last trump shall be. So we need to get our ears in tune for that trumpet. And this time, don't be scared. Are you ready to meet Jesus? Are you really ready to meet Jesus? Think about it. Everything I say today is going to have kind of a said, not go ahead. Everything I say today is going to have something to do with my sermon, but we're going to keep it just a little relaxed, because what it does with you being ready to keep meet Jesus has to do with faith. Now, that's a big word in the circles that I recently came out of, faith. Faith. Hebrews 1, 11, 1. You want to turn there real quick? I want you to see it. And God say amen.
Amen.
And I know it right off the top of my head, I gotta read it. Faith, substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Faith, the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Today I'm kind of in a fun way to demonstrate as well as to tell you how I got to this point, and hopefully through that we'll get a kind of a grasp on what faith is. How many people here know my middle name? Can you stand for me? Did I lose all my middle name people? I had several people with here that did know my middle name. I think they went out with the young people. So my wife knows my middle name. Please, can you go around and tell about four people my middle name? And while she's doing that, I'm going to tell you a story about how I got to this point. It all started back in, we're going to start this story back in 96. Well, let's go back a little. January 96. The Lord had We lived too long out of a Baptist church, where we had got into the non-denominational Pentecostal type movement maybe a couple of years before we started going to what's called Word of Faith. Some of you may have heard of him, called Bishop Butler. So we had New Year's Eve service, and before that, without getting into all that, the Lord had laid on my heart about going to Rhema. But we was wavering in that. So we was at New Year's Eve service, my wife and I. This happened just like it took. Bishop Butler was preaching. All of a sudden, my wife and I sitting there, and the lights in the whole building went out. I mean, and it was just a light on him. And it's like he came off the stage and put his finger in my wife and I's face and said, "If you don't get out of that ankle-deep water and get it to water over your knees, you're going to drown." And then everything went back. It had noise to it, too. And he went back to preaching. We looked at each other. Whoa! So, and our heart, we knew what it was talking about. We were supposed to come down here to the rainbow. Understand, we still haven't really got into this faith movement. So we came down here. We went looking for a house. And some place to stay, and so we got turned on to a Jewish gentleman who was into finances. But everybody kept telling us, "Well, you cannot finance a house down there." Because I already had, I'm not a renter. I am very serious about that. I do not rent. I buy. And for some reason, the Lord put that in my mind. I buy, I don't rent. So we came down here, people said, "Well, you can't buy no house unless you got a job." I didn't have a job. Wife didn't have a job. We ran to the Jewish gentleman. I just taken off from my job with General Motors. She took off from her job at Ford. We come down here. I mean, we gave up all to make this movement. So we working with this Jewish gentleman. We found, went out. So he said, "Go out and find your house and we'll see what we do." So we went out and we make a long story short, we found this little bitty house. And it was little. My son called it, what do you call it, apartment? A hotel room. He called it a hotel room. It was so small. You know, but I'm sacrificing. I want to obey the Lord. You hear what I said? I want to obey the Lord. I didn't know nothing about faith and all that stuff. I want to obey the Lord. So We made the decisions to go into this house and we started the process. You know what? We got approved to buy a house and didn't have no job. Because I wanted to obey the Lord. So we got in the house and we got early occupancy before everything closed, because there was some contingents that our house in Detroit would close before we can actually buy this house here. So we had buyers before we left and everything. So the house in Detroit, glory to God, the house in Detroit fell through. It just fell through. So we're in the house and all of a sudden, we're supposed to close, we can't close. So we get to find out things about this house. So I don't know what it was, Lord led me to a window. I pushed on the window and my hand went through it. Termite infested. No wonder the house fell through. In the house in Detroit. So we said, we can't buy this house. And the people who owned the house got very, they wouldn't fix it. They got very angry about it. They wanted us to get out. And they gave us like 2 weeks to get out. We had to find somewhere else to stay. And we had to get out of their house. Got down to like about a week or so before we had it. I think it was within a few days, if I remember right. And we had to get out of this house. So my wife, by that time, I had got a job with a coming home, which was kind of crazy. Because back in the time, you ever knew about come and go, it was like quick trip. But one of the reasons come and go went down was because back in that time, they was having a lot of crime situations. Few people even died. People were coming in, they threw them in the freezer, or one incident, about to be graphic, and I messed them up, and few people died. And I'm sitting up in this situation in the rough area. But I didn't know. I'm coming from Detroit. I just had to have a job. So my wife would go out and look for a job. She used to go out and look for a house, rather. And she saw this house that was, way out of our budget. But she really liked it. So this got down to like about a couple of days before we're supposed to get out. Let me do this real quick in the midst of this. How many people know my middle name now? Stand up. You know my middle name? Go step, tell a couple people while I'm telling this story. My middle name. I'm showing you something. So we're out looking for a house a few days before we're supposed to get out of here. We're out looking for a house. We're not seeing nothing that's working out. But it was in the neighborhood in which my wife saw this house she really liked. So we was kind of depressed and down. So she had told me about it. And I said, well, we're in that neighborhood. Let's go look at this house. That's kind of like window shopping, something to pick you up. You know, it's nothing elsewhere. So the real estate lady took us over to the house. We went in the house. And it was like 4 or 5 times bigger than the house we were getting before. I mean, it was huge. Really. So we went in, I looked at it, I'm like, man, this is a nice house, you know. So I came out of the house, I jumped in the car. Well, no, I was about ready to get in the car. Lise was coming out of the house, the real estate lady was coming out of the house, and they had just got to the car. And I turned around, being from Detroit, I was about ready to do something, because this guy come running out of the house, running at us. I'm like, okay. You know, you get that city complex, you know, somebody running at you, you can't get on your guard. You know, so he runs at us and he goes, oh, by the way, I lowered the cost of the house. I'm not talking a couple of $1,000. He lowered this bad boy way down, right into our budget. Right into our budget. These eyes lit up. I mean, this is like $10,000. This ain't a couple of thousand. It's $10,000, right into our budget. So these eyes lit up, the real estate lady's eyes lit up, and I just looked up. Glory to God. So we went to the our finance guy and gave him all the information, and he started proceedings on buying this house. make a long story short, the house in Detroit all of a sudden, but there's more story to it about the house in Detroit. Some fires came from the house in Detroit, everything closed, it's like dominoes, there's like things that falling down into place. That fall right down into place. This car. We moved in the house Thanksgiving Eve. Hear me now. We moved in this house Thanksgiving Eve. We started moving in. Thanksgiving Day, we didn't have a Thanksgiving turkey. Now we moving boxes, straightening up stuff, trying to get ready for so we have somewhere to sleep. And Denise was in the yard and I was working, putting stuff together. Go back a little bit. We used to do ministering and witnessing in the Bahamas. When you go to the Bahamas to play on the beach, you went to the out islands where they didn't even have bathrooms or wash up there. And we would help the ministers on that island do a lot of ministry. So Denise one time went to one island that I didn't get a chance to go to, and some big person, Coca-Cola owned a house on that island. And she got to stay in the house. It was very Gothic. They had all these white Gothic statues everywhere. And Denise had her first experience with actually dealing with demons. Actually dealing with demons. So when we get to the house, we got a new house now. I'm doing my stuff on the inside, she's out on the outside doing her stuff. All of a sudden she runs in the house, she said, "Michael, we gotta get rid of that statue. I am not dealing with that statue out there in the yard." And I haven't seen it yet. And it rolls up in me to tell her, and I told her, I said, "No, we're gonna leave that statue right where it is." So she went back inside and bothered her again. She came back in again. She said, "No, I'm not dealing with that statue out there," because of the incident she dealt with those demonic spirits in the Bahamas. She didn't want no white Gothic looking statue around her. So I said, "Wait a minute, let's go out here and look at this statue." So, man, come on. So we walk around, it's kind of like a walking around the corner, and we get to the statue. Alright, statue is along the fence, it's a bunch of bushes about this high. Statue is sitting right there. And we stood there and we was holding hands. All of a sudden both our eyes opened up. This statue was a ram in the bush. Anybody understand the significance of a ram in the bush? Glory to God. Not because I knew about faith and all this, it's all about obedience. When I was obedient to God in Detroit to come down here, things begin to happen. Faith, the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Let's break it down. And how many people know my name, my middle name right now? Stand up. Faith, the substance of things hoped for, evidence of things not seen. What I just did is demonstrated what faith did. They stood up because I said so. Faith, the substance. They heard about something that they believed to be true. Belief, the evidence, the belief of evidence to know what it is. They trusted in what was told them. So when I said to stand up, they stood up. Faith has trust in it. Sit down. But they sat down. So it's all wrapped up in what? Obedience. Obedience. Abraham was obedient to sacrifice his son, and God counted it unto him as being faithful. So if you don't know anything else, pastor has been working hard, the anointing has been on him to teach us how to be humble. teaches about humility. It teaches about submission and authority. To raise this church up, to grow this church up. So God can do a mighty work in it, and He is. Something's going to happen here. Because you all are a remnant. A mighty remnant that God's going to use. That's why I'm all right here. But don't get confused about that word, faith. If you're going to name my sermon today, my sermon is to be named. Where is your faith? Because the Bible tells us in Romans 12:3. Turn to Romans 12:3. I'm not going to keep you long today. I just want to give a little talking to you today. Turn to Romans 12:3. And I like including my wife. I do that because I want everybody to see that we are a married couple. So much, we get involved in so much running around, even in church activities. She's over here doing this, I'm over here doing that. And as often as I can, I want her to come stand with me and be involved with whatever I do. So can you stand and read that for me, please? Yeah.
For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think.
Humility. Being humble. The first thing about the pastor's teaching us. We got to get humble. We have got to get, why we got to get humble?
But to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned.
Because He's put faith in you. It ain't nothing you have to get, thank you. It's nothing you have to get. Faith is already in you. You just need to humble yourself and be obedient to that what God has already put in you. But unfortunately, we get hung up in what's going on in the world today. We've been hung up at what goes on at work. So we put our faith in our work and ourselves and what we can do to accomplish what we want to do. We put our faith in our jobs, saying our jobs is our supply. We put our faith in this country, thinking that this country is going to protect us. We put our faith everywhere but what is supposed to be put, placed in the Lord Jesus Christ, because He's coming in.
Yes.
Get your faith back where it's supposed to be. Talking to myself now too. But we have been caught up in this world so tough. God has given us a gift of faith. And we have placed it in all these other areas and not where it's supposed to be. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John told us a story about a man and gave us a name that's above all names. Where is your faith? Acts took that name, took that power, and placed it in us that we can do the works that He did, but even more. Where is your faith? Obedience. That's all it is. Take the word and do what it says to do. The rest of the Bible tells us how to act in situations, small groups, families, in the church. And then we get to Revelation. So all this is leading up to Revelation. And Revelation tells us one main thing. He's coming again. He's coming. So all this is in preparation of Him coming again. He gave you a gift of faith to prepare for His coming again. He gave you a gift of faith to be obedient to his word. Not to the world. Not to your job. Not even to your spouse. In obedience to his word, you will submit to your spouse. Being obedient to his word, you will love your wives. Now, I'll give you a little quick nugget here. It's for you men. I find it very precarious that you never see, or I haven't found, if anybody finds it, let me know, where it tells the wife to love the husband. It tells the husband, the man, to love his wife. Why? Really doesn't matter. I'm gonna tell you why you gotta come to that class. But it really doesn't matter. If you be obedient to his faith. Faith. Take that faith. And be obedient to that faith. Submit yourself to those who have been placed in authority over you. Take what they give you and work it. Work it. And we really need to work it hard. Because I am a desperate person on end times right now. That little nugget I gave you, if you feel it in your heart to do so, study the feast of the Jews. And that's kind of a misrepresentation, because if you study it out, it's the feast of God. God gave these feasts to his people for the world. He didn't give them just for the Jews. But those feasts represent, the spring feasts represent the death, burial, resurrection of Jesus. It's types and shadows of death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. The fall feast, where we're in now, and there's another one coming up here, on the 23rd, represent the coming again of Christ, the preparation, which is starting today. The blowing of the horn is to remind you that Christ is coming again. The next one that's coming up is the Day of Atonement. So who is our atonement? Jesus. Jesus is our atonement. So coming again of Jesus. And they believe he's coming again with that trumpet shout on that day. Not that particular day, but in that time frame. God does have a calendar that puts us in a season. He does have a calendar. So what I'm saying in this little quick talk with you all, that we need to exercise the faith that God has given us by being obedient to the word. Being obedient to what we've been taught. Being obedient, not to the world, not to our jobs. I'm not telling you it's going to be easy, because we've got kind of hung up in a habit, old habits are hard to break. We got kind of hung up in the world, but we got to start letting it go. Because the times are near, Samuel. The times are near. You, my son, shall be a great protector of many people. You, my son, being obedient to my word, being obedient to who I am, will be used in a way that you would never imagine. I will do abundantly above all that you ask of me, and your family shall prosper. Who said it? I don't know. Pray, I die. Jesus. Who will take on me? Who will take on me? Obedience. Faith. Substance. Things hoped for. Obedience. One of the things that my wife and I are working with, we're not getting into a big lot of hoopla in the ministry, in the youth ministry. We taking the hoopla out for a reason. And we found out that this works mightily. You might not think so sometimes when you see them walk out of class, they go like, oh. You know, they look like, oh, I was so bored and I was so, but I'm not worried about them. I know God's word. When we get that word in there, we got a couple here that can testify to it that it was in a youth class before. We get that word into them, when the time comes, it will rise up. But right now, we're trying to get them to understand and to discipline themselves to hear the Holy Spirit. Because we got so involved in the world, we think the Holy Spirit comes with this mighty It's a still, quiet, small voice. And if you're so busy, it'll go right past you. You got to learn, discipline yourself, pull back out of this world, faith. Woo! Faith. We keep hearing that word, that's why I'm putting it down to you like this. We don't understand it. We think it's some big thing that Abraham, Isaac, all of them did, and we're not able to do it. It's really a simple thing. Faith is nothing but obedience to the word of God. Take your trust off yourself, take your trust in the world, and put your trust in God. Quit looking for the big fantastic thing to happen. You're going to see this movie. You're going to see this movie called War Room. I'm praying that it changes lives, that you turn that TV off. Take that TV and throw it in the closet and make your whole house war room. And when somebody come in your house, you see your daughter go by speaking in tongues, and they go like, okay. The whole house is a war room. I got upset a little while ago, back when they took prayer out of schools, and people kind of, I'm a little weird anyway, but people kind of got on me and talking about, because I didn't really get into participating and getting prayer back in the schools, and I told them, school is not the problem. When they took prayer out of school, it showed you that there was no prayer going on in the homes. How are you going to fix something that has nothing to do with nothing? The home is where we got to fix. The home is where we got to get the prayer back. Faith, the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So when you hear somebody talk about faith and all these big faith people in the Bible, hear faith. And know that it's just obedience. Who got a favorite scripture real quick? Just plot it out. I'll show you something real quick.
God so loved the world that he...
Give me the book, chapter, and verse.
John 3:16.
The things hoped for. The evidence, the things not seen. Did you hear me? John, who got another scripture? Just throw your scripture in there. Don't say faith. Throw the scripture that's pertaining to you right now, that you need right now. That is the thing hoped for. The evidence not seen. Evidence of things not seen. Because the word is alive. The word is made flesh. And just like the word was made flesh in Jesus, it becomes alive and flesh in you. So where is your faith? We got Almighty God. We sung this song today that God be for you, who can be against you? Where is your faith? If you truly believe and know that God is God,
amen.
I just wanted to talk to you today. kind of one big, little big Cooper lot. And last time I was up here, we really praised the Lord. But I felt it necessary to hear what was going on at the pig neck, and I had a sermon. I really get down and have some real good praise. So I pray that the Holy Spirit has opened up each and every one of you on this heart right now to hear what I'm saying. Faith is nothing but obedience in God's word. Take your faith out of the world and put it back in the word where it belongs. And listen to what pastor is teaching us and guiding us to do. And when we leave out of here, no matter what comes against us, we don't set down all that and stay focused on what we got to do. Be humble and pray. Get our war room. Start fighting. It's on our knees. You hear me, man? I'm really talking to the men right now because they're the one that inspired me yesterday. Our fight is on our knees. We got to pray like there's no tomorrow. But we got to be humble. Getting our past. We got to be humble and trusting in God. Not in who we are. Amen. Amen. Don't mess with me. We gotta be humble because the word says we gotta turn the other cheek. Oh yeah, we gotta get to that type of humility where somebody slaps us in one cheek. Talking to you men, we gotta turn the other cheek. Now, I'm not saying you don't let somebody walk in there and hurt your family. Distinguish that difference. So I am a man. And I will take a life in a minute to save a life. No hesitation. We gotta have our masculinity in check with God. Humility. He tells you when to move. So we can be placed back as hidden as we should be. Last, very last, and I'm gonna end with this. The very last prophecy in the Bible, in Malachi, is in the last chapter, says, I shall bring the love of fathers back to the children, love the children back to the father. But I think it's also mentioned in Luke. But what that is referring to is bringing back the order of the family and the order of his existence. We're not only turning to our fathers, our earthly, but our spiritual fathers. He's bringing back that order. And then he combines it that if you don't comply with that, you're going to be hit with a curse. But we know God don't really curse anybody. It's just that you have stepped out from under his anointing. And you give the devil permission to whack you anywhere he wants to go because now you're not in line with what God wants done. Now God's a good God. We need to stay with him. Faith, the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Before you can acquire that faith, though, you've got to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. God so loved us that he gave his only begotten Son that we can be brought back to him and call him Father. God so loved us that it doesn't matter what you have done, he has forgiven all your sins. All you have to do is accept his Son. And once you accept his Son and believe that he was born of a virgin, died on the cross, and rose again, believe it in your heart, and then confess it with your mouth, a transformation takes form in you, in your spirit. Your spirit. You become a new creation, spiritually. You no longer have a sin nature. That's why a lot of saved people, when they get saved, if they're not in a church that teaches the word, they don't understand the conflict that begins to roar up in them, because your spirit and your soul begins to fight, because you got all these bad habits going on, and your spirit is constantly telling your arm, we don't do that anymore. But your mind, because it hasn't been renewed in the word, begins to say, man, what was so good? I had so much fun. Because your spirit said, you serve the Lord, you know. So you get this war going on inside yourself. Because after you get saved, you have to renew your mind. But I say that to say, if there's anyone in here who hasn't accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you need to do that right now. I'm going to count to three. But when I do so, just raise your hand if you haven't accepted. No one in here is going to judge you. It's not about what you've done, your sins. We're not here to judge you. We're here to help you. I've gotten to the point in the Bible that I don't really give my opinion about anything anymore. Very, very seldom, because I know the Bible tells you that called to be ambassadors. If you know the concept of an ambassador, when an ambassador is in a foreign land, it is actually against the law for the ambassador to give his own personal opinion about anything. All that the ambassador can do is tell you what his head of the country tells him what to say to you. So I've been called as an ambassador to tell you to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And if you haven't, to lead you in that. So I'm going to count to three real quick. And if you haven't accepted the Lord as your Savior, let's see those hands stepped up. One, like I say, Lord loved us. He loved us so much that he took his son and sent him in this filthy, dirty, you don't know, this is all you know. You won't really see how filthy and dirty this world is when you get to heaven. But this is a filthy, dirty, corrupt place. Send his son in here. Not just to come teach us, but he died for us. He went through the process of death for us, for me, for you. Two. Then he rose when they buried him. He went down the hill and took back the authority that the devil had taken from Adam. I said taken from Adam. And we're going to get that to Mary's class as to how he took it from Adam. But he took it from Adam. And Jesus went and my vernacular beat him to his teeth. Not a single one was left. He was a gumless devil. Gumless devil, and took that authority back. And then he did something amazing. He gave it to those who accepted him as Lord and Savior. Three, if you have been accepting Jesus as your Lord and Savior, let me see you raise your hand. Oh, glory to God. Every time I see this, it dawns on my heart and confirms the fact that you are the remnant of Northside Christian Center that's going to bring about a mighty change in this church. Mighty change in this church. But I have one other question for you. John said, there's going to be another come who's going to baptize you in the Spirit. Jesus told them to go into that upper room, and they are to wait on the baptism, not only in the Spirit, but in spirit and in power. So if you haven't received the baptism of the Holy Ghost in spirit and in power, with the evidence of speaking in tongues, it's a necessary experience that you should go through. Because we can't do anything without the Holy Spirit. It's one of the things we're teaching, we're going through with Brother our students. You can't do anything without the Holy Spirit. Everything you do without the Holy Spirit, and you go to save, you go to heaven, but everything you do without the Holy Spirit, and you when you get to heaven, you think you've done something, you're going to burn that up. That ain't nothing but twigs. He ain't even going to look at that stuff. So you need the Holy Spirit to walk this world. That your husband? Yeah. Right here. So since I don't have nobody to really catch you right now, in case the Holy Spirit moves on you. Y'all don't go crazy, guys, okay? Sarah. She was a woman, just like all of you all human beings just like us men, but what's the difference that Sarah was able to do what she did with Abraham? Yeah, she went on the other side of the fence, and us doing something like that. I'm going to tell you the difference. It's called faith and obedience. She was God conscious. She wasn't self-conscious. Sarah didn't care about herself. What she cared about was accomplishing what God wanted for Abraham. Yes, she stepped over to the other side of the road and did try to do it on her own instead of consulting with God. But her heart, that's because she was still named as one of the great women of faith, because her heart was with God. She wanted to do what God, she wanted to sacrifice herself and do what God wanted, not what Sarah wanted. Think about it. That's called humility. So thank you, Northside Christian Center. I love you all. By the grace of God, I hope you're around for a while. Praise the word really, really, really minister to you. And get a boldness, please. Get a boldness. That's it. Grace. Hallelujah, what a blessing. All right, we just thank God for that word and that relationship with me was obedience component. That's what faith actually boils down to be. Amen. And we appreciate that word. It was direct, down to earth, and simple. And I believe everybody got how important it is for us to obey the word of God. How they can say, some people say, well, I don't obey God's word, but I don't obey no man's word. I only obey the Holy Ghost. All right, that's the reason why he's praying at this point. So we have to obey him and have what rule over. Today, God is speaking to us today so that we can position ourselves for revival. And these lessons are very serious, but many times we count things that God gives through delegated authority, like pastors. You don't consider that as important. Amen. But this is the beginning of what God wants to do in your life. Without the foundation being laid, and without you obeying and working these lessons out, you know, we've spent too much time in idleness, losing time, you know, not being fruitful and productive in the kingdom of God. And our time is running out. The thing that we are going to do must do for the Lord. It must be done. And it must be done quickly. God has manifested his approval upon this because many of the students that's going through this material, they other night they said, the Lord has placed this person on my heart. I want to study with those that can't come. I want to study with those that don't clearly understand the lessons that are being presented. This message has to be got over, and it's not gonna happen to you. Amen. Got over through you. I'm giving it to you. You don't have to take it and give it to others. I want to tell you, amen, sometimes we think that obedience is just obeying, you know, the most important thing, but obedience is important in small things. And today it was so important. The second thing, this book here is a book that contains the meditations of all that God has spoken to us in the last 2 or 3 or 4 years. Things that we have taught. The area that we are teaching now is all in here. God says that we need to take meditation serious. How can God begin revival in us if we won't obey our leaders and those that God is saying? As established, amen, in the body of Christ. That's the kind of obedience, that's how I took what Brother Michael was saying this morning. Unless we take serious what God is doing, the path that God is leading us, we will have revival. There are prerequisites for revival. Amen. And it starts with being willing to submit to those that God is speaking through. And I must also say that some of these courses that's going on in this church that y'all have access to, y'all can do some of these things. Because the devil is teaching a class on prayer. So the Denise is teaching a class on righteousness. And all of these things are right in line with God is speaking to this church, this country. I want to see revival. How many want to see revival? It's got to start with the Word. Tell somebody, it's got to start with the Word. The Word. Everybody say the Word. Not only are we going to be giving exams, little tests to be handed out, I'm bringing all of us. I'm seeing people that are obedient and submitting. I'm seeing who it is. Amen. But not only am I going to do lessons on the book here for you to turn into me, I'm going to do lessons in here to see, to get you to read it. It's like the only way I know I can get you to read, to meditate. So you're going to have lessons made up on the meditations. Amen. And also, God is also speaking the importance of reaching out. Everybody just say reaching out. That is so important. That's how the hunger, the thirst, the fervency, and the zeal, amen, begins to come and release us. Hold everybody at this time. Why don't you stand on your feet? We're going to let you go. Hallelujah. That was a powerful message. Amen. But I'm looking for every member to submit to what God is speaking to us through these lessons. This has to be handed down. The children need to know this. The teens need to know this. Parents need to know this. They need to understand how important it is to obey. Obedience is better than sacrifice. To hearken better than the fat of rams. And I'm praying that this will be a church that will what? Fall in line with God's will and God's plan, the things that God has released into this ministry for us to take out and to reach the world and to bring the world into harmony with God's plan. The end is coming. Jesus is coming. Amen. Soon, this country has to turn to God. We don't have no options. Amen. And this is the day that God has said, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves. My people who are called by my name. Humility starts with the Word, receiving the Word, placing yourself in a position. Because you are not here on Wednesday night does not excuse you from doing the things that God is speaking to us to do in this ministry. It's your responsibility, if you're not in this class, to come to Pastor Hill and say, Pastor, I want to be in submission. I want the lessons. I want the meditation material. I want to get into the flow of what you are calling for us, because revival is important. And this is the day that we have the opportunity to turn to God with all of our heart. How many want to see believers that's serious again, that's broken again, that's contrite, that's praying and seeking God, that will be willing to come and pay whatever price it takes for us to get hold of God and to see some changes, amen, occur in our homes and our families and our communities. Amen. Father, today we thank you again as we leave this place. Lord, let revival come to me. Lord, I want to go up to a higher level. I want more compassion, more zeal, more fervency. I want to come to the point where I can say, not my will, but thy will be done. Lord, if it takes all night sometimes, if it takes hours, sometimes, say hallelujah, in the word, in prayer, in reaching out. Lord, that fervency, that zeal, restore unto us the joy of our salvation. Restore unto us the joy of our salvation so that we can teach sinners, hallelujah, thy ways, and transgressors will be converted back to you. Father, we thank you now in Jesus' name.
revival, revive my spirit. Lord, your recipe for revival is still the same. It hasn't changed. You change it not. In you there is no variableness, neither shadow of dirt. My people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray. Lord, it takes fasting, it takes prayer, it takes enduring hardness as a good soldier. It takes focusing on the things that you're interested in, the things that you're speaking to our hearts in this church under our leaders. It takes hearkening and heeding your voice. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, it's prayer time. Lord, we realize it's praying time.
Yes.
It's praying time. We can see the handwriting on the wall. We can see that the end of this nation and the condition of this nation has come up before you, Lord. And you are not pleased where we are in you. Hallelujah. You said if we would seek your face and turn from our wicked way. Lord, it takes the word to get our attention. It takes the word to have the effect upon us that it needs to in order for us to turn to you and humble ourselves. We have to see ourselves as you see us. And Father, today we thank you that it's time for us to heed and to hearken and to turn to you with all of our heart. In Jesus' name, Lord, we thank you now unto you that's able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before your presence with exceeding great joy. To the only wise God be glory, honor, dominion, and power, both now and forever. Everybody said together, praise the Lord. I want you to say this with me, Lord, spare me. I want to experience revival. Revive me. Turn my heart back to you. Turn my heart back to your word. Back to obedience. Back to sincere faith. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Amen.